Okay, so we're looking at lava here, and this is typical of Hawaii. And I want us to think about what are some of the volcanic rocks or igneous extrusive rocks that we could have from this. So I'm going to start out with basalt. Okay. Let's take a look and see if I can make that move forward. So basalt's dark colored. Do you remember the name for a dark colored rock? It has magnesium and iron in it. It starts with an M. Putting you guys on the spot. Yeah, mafic. Mafic, right? Nice. Okay, let's take a look at the next slide. And hopefully this thing's going to work. Oh, goodness. Yeah, I want to hit the next one. You want to just do that for me? Oh. Let me just see. Okay, so this is a volcano, and this blew up. This is a unique picture right in here. This is Mount St. Helens, and it blew up in 1980. Okay, and it has all kinds of medium-colored rocks, and I have a picture of that right in here. This is andesite. Okay, andesite is it's starting to get more and more felsic. Okay, and don't forget that one. So there's our intermediate lava rock. And this is Mount Shasta in the background. Brian, can you see if you can focus that? There's a little knob right there. There you go. Yeah, that's it right there. And you can see right in the background, this is Mount Shasta. And that's part of the Cascades, like I mentioned, along that subduction zone here. Mount Lassen's to the south of that. This is serpentine, by the way, this rock up in here. And here is, look, there's another volcano right in here. Isn't that cool? It's called Black Butte. Okay, it should, Brian, I think it'll focus it on itself. Yeah, that way it doesn't wobble. This is rhyolite. Okay, and this is the light-colored rock. This is felsic. And this is what rhyolite looks like in nature. This is in Idaho when we went rafting and kayaking. You can see that it's resistant to erosion. So it's very cliffy. It's got a protrusion there like a pinnacle. And that's a funny shot of me backpacking here. Nice shorts, huh? this is Devil's Post Pile. It's near Yosemite on the back side of the Sierra Nevadas. And basalt can have what we call columnar joining. Hey, you see these columns that are going vertical? As the lava cools and contracts, it creates these cracks like columns. This is near Susanville, and you can see the kind of the side view here. I was driving along and then saw columnar joining. It's not nearly as spectacular. Okay, yeah, I guess you got to focus this one, Brian. This is in Yosemite. I went on a month-long backpacking trip through the Sierra Nevadas, and the Pacific Crest Trail goes from basically Canada or from Mexico all the way up to Canada. I think that's about as good as you can get it for right now. What happens is the slides warp as the bulb heats it up and then it gets out of focus. This is the Matterhorn Canyon, and it has been glaciated, so it has like a U shape to it. And this is granite. It's an igneous intrusive rock. This might have been placed in the Sierra Nevadas 150 million years ago, somewhere in that time zone. And then through erosion, it's exposed. Okay, but this granite was actually made a long, long time ago. Lots of wildflowers as the water stands. Doesn't percolate very easily through the granite. This is in July. And snowfields, here we are cruising over the high passes of the Sierra Nevada. Again, you can see it's a U shape from the glaciers. And this is lupin, lots of colors. And this is Dick's Pass in the Desolation Wilderness in Lake Tahoe. And we started to get into more and more volcanics. So you can see here is the igneous intrusive granites. But the darker colored rocks are the volcanic. So as we start heading toward Lake Tahoe, you can visibly see the landscape change. This is, anybody want to take a guess where this is? Here in Rockland, some of you may go skiing, and this is one of the ski areas. This is Lake Tahoe. It was a smoky day in the summertime. This is Squaw Valley. Squaw Valley had this bungee jumping apparatus that they set up at the high camp there. And the Pacific Crest Trail goes underneath some of these ski areas, the Shirley's Lake ski lift. This is granite. It's got a mind of its own. And this is us heading down from Squaw Valley down to Interstate 80. Lake Tahoe's to the right. And you can see the lighter color volcanics. So we're probably looking at andesites and rhyolites in here. To the north are the Sierra Buttes, which have ancient volcanics. Okay. I'll just say next if it doesn't work. Brian, you get extra credit here. We also have lots of faults here in the west, and that creates these very grand mountains. These are the Grand Tetons in Wyoming. And they abruptly come up high. And so we're going to get some really deeply formed rocks. Along that fault line, it'll shove rocks up to the surface. They may have been 13,000 feet below the surface. Now they're, you know, right there at the surface. So I'll show you a picture of some rocks. I also have a picture of a moose here that kind of chased me down. You have to get across this lake to the trailhead. And that's the, this is a picture I took of the Grand Tetons. See if my clicker works. Nope. I was a tour guide in 1993, and these are some folks from England, Switzerland, and France, these two young women. And here we are on the trailhead heading up. You can go for about a half day up here. You can see, look at this, isn't this cool how pretty these mountains are? Give it a shot. Nope. And there's the moose. Now, I had been told moose are pretty mean animals. They come and stomp your feet, stomp your head with their feet. And so I was hiding behind a tree while he decided to, I don't think he attacked me, but he was just kind of doing his thing. Nope. Brian, can you hit that? And that's me a while ago, hanging out at the, it looks like a Photoshop job, except for this is a slide. So it's kind of a fake backdrop, isn't it? Okay, and that's the Grand Tetons. Yeah, next slide. These are these darkly formed rocks, the igneous intrusive with some, look at how large those crystals are. Isn't that great? These are called pegmatites when they have these very large crystals. Okay, next. And this is our high Sierra Nevadas. This is Kings Canyon, Sequoia National Park. And you can see the granites. But you can also see the glaciers, how they've carved out those lakes. You see how they would have slowly scooped out the rock there. Okay, next slide. And granites exfoliate. So we had columnar joining for lavas like basalt. But granites in the high Sierras exfoliate. So Half Dome's a good example of that. And I climbed that during these tours when I went to Grand Teton. So let's take a look at Yosemite now. And so has anybody ever climbed Half Dome? Yeah, one person here has. You have to go up these rails. It's actually like a cable. When I went up, they have gloves you can borrow. And you have to go up this spine. Okay, so this is an exfoliated dome. And the back side of it got glaciated and cut, undercut, and actually eroded away. So let's take a look at the next slide. That's on top of Half Dome, looking up toward Tenaya Canyon, toward the east, northeast. And you can see how rounded the rock is. That's from exfoliation. That's all granites in place there over 100 million years ago. Okay, next. Granite does also fracture like this in a more linear fashion. In fact, this is a lot more common for granite to decompose and fracture like that. This is on the Oregon coast. Okay, next slide. Our second rock was sedimentary rocks, and remember there were three subclasses. And the first one was the clastics, or these fragments. Okay, they've been pushed together through enormous pressure and some natural cementation. You can see the layers. Do you remember what we called the layers? Okay, here's the layers of the sandstone. This is in Zion National Park in Utah. It's strata, right? So you can remember sedimentary rocks have strata, and this is a sandstone. It's under the clastic subtype. Let's see if this will work again. Nope, next one. We also have claystones, shales would be a good example of that. You can see how more finely grained this is, okay? And this is a conglomerate. This is in Death Valley, Mosaic Canyon. Here's a field studies class we did. And you can see how the rock has just all been, breccia, I think is the specific name, but how all these fragments have been welded together. Okay, next. And this is definitely a conglomerate here. You see all the cobbles and giant medium-sized boulders here. This is heading into Susanville. It's an ancient riverbed, and these have been naturally cemented together. You wouldn't have such a steep cliff if these were not cemented together. Okay, next. And this is chalk. The second category of rocks is organic. Okay, coal is an example, limestone, chalk, that have ancient, usually marine, organisms, small organisms that die and then become part of the rock. Okay. And here in the California Coast Range, we have layers of old marine sediments. This is a layer that I'm pointing to right in here. So lots of old, basically ocean sediments that have accumulated. You see the layers? Okay. And I believe that's diatomaceous earth, and it's kind of more of this color here. It's very slippery when it gets wet. Okay, next. And in Southern California, there's a place called Palo Verdes. And let's hit the next slide. I want to show you what happened here. In the 1960s, I believe, I don't know the exact dates, they were going to blast a road over the top of these mountains here. This is old marine terraces. And when they did the blasting, they sent this hillside toward the ocean. It is slowly sliding every day, just inching its way toward the ocean. This road, Pacific Coast Highway, they actually have to rebuild this section of the road every few months. They have to move the pipes and maintain that road frequently, because right in here you can see this whole area of sediments is sliding into the ocean. So that was a mistake for them to try to blast a road over the top. They never finished the road, and to this day it's called the Portuguese Span landslide is still occurring. Okay. And I showed you on the internet some pictures. This is a picture I took of Havasu Pie Falls. And this is a the third category, which is a chemical precipitate. I abbreviate to precipitate, but it's more commonly referred to as chemical, like your book talks about. And it's, look at how beautiful this is. This is natural. This is a picture, slide I took. And travertine is the rock. You'll see a lot of that around here, and limestones in that area. Here's that picture I scanned, showed you guys earlier. You can see the milkiness in the water there. In the desert southwest, you see lots of layers indicative of sedimentary rocks, ancient limestones, ancient sandstones. And this is the goosenecks of the San Juan in Utah. Another famous place is in Moab, Utah. It's called Arches National Park. What happens with sandstones is it starts to crack, fracture along these plains. You can see there I am for scale. And let's take a look at the next one. But probably the most famous landmark in Utah is the Delicate Arch. Here's a person for scale, okay? And look at just how gorgeous that is. That's the remnants of those fins that you saw, the sandstone. And everything's eroded around it, and that's what's left. It's a little bit more resistant to erosion, and so it's still just sticking straight up in the sky. Has anybody ever seen that? Maybe just raise your hand, just a couple of you guys. So that's on your bucket list. I recommend to see Arches National Park. And that's zooming out to see scale. There's a couple people in the background there. Okay. Also in the southern part of Utah, people lived in these canyons and they built their houses up in these cliffs. Okay, the Anasazi, the Fremont. They probably had this prolonged drought and may have had warfare with one another. But can you see the logs up here in the rocks? They would have these ladders to go up there. Okay, next. This is all sandstone. There's their dwellings, these cliff dwellings. Mesa Verdes. Verdes is a famous national monument to see. Okay, next. And these are petrified sand dunes. In Zion National Park are these ancient sand dunes from, you know, a long time ago that have been now turned into rock, basically. Okay, next. Here's a picture. I was a tour guide when I went to the Tetons. You saw those pictures. Here's another group. This is a Dutch group, Escalet. I don't know if you can see me in there. I'm right down here. They're all Dutch. And we took this picture in front of some. Check it out. You can see the old sand dunes right in here, all embedded in the rocks. Okay. Grand Canyon's famous for its layer. Here's a slide. Let's take a look at the next one. You can see the river down below here. And we're talking, you know, some of the oldest rocks on our planet are at the bottom there. Lots of cool colors and limestones. Let's take a look at the next slide. So these are sedimentary rocks. Devil's Post pile, we saw that earlier. This is the pinnacle, or the minarets. Okay, that's straddling Yosemite's National Park. And you can see these ancient layers right in here, probably something to do with the old Earth history. I don't know exactly its Earth history, but I do know that rock is very resistant to erosion, right? It's probably been metamorphosed. There's a very good chance that's metamorphic rock, and that's why it's still sticking straight up in the sky like that. Okay, next. More metamorphic rocks. A couple things about them. They're hard. Remember that? That's the number one characteristic to remember. And then number two, that they can be foliated or banded. And if you look here closely, you can start to see this marble does show signs of banding. Let's take a look at the next slide. Here we can see that the ancient layers. And this is rocks that you'd find in Italy, these ancient marbles. Marble, remember, used to be what rock? Marble is metamorphosed what? Nope. Limestones. Limestones. Okay, next. Okay, and this is our departing shot. This is Death Valley. It's got all kinds of rocks there. It's got the sedimentary rocks. It's got the igneous rocks, and it has the metamorphic rocks there as well. Okay, so that's it.